From Vassar College, this is Conversations at the Salt Line with Wesley Dixon. On this episode, a conversation with Jason Blum.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Wesley Dixon, and you are listening to Conversations at the Salt Line. I am here today with Vassar alum, class of 91, and I might say super producer, Jason Blum. Thank you for being here, Jason.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm excited to talk to you.
Thank you. And who is our other guest we have here?
This is my son, Booker Blum, who's my executive assistant, who will be helping us out with this interview today.
Thank you for being here, Booker. And I got a little intel. I have a question. What is that statue behind Booker's shoulder?
This is a great question.
And it's naked.
Naked. This is, my wife gave me this. It says Father of the Year. This is a made-up stat. This is a made-up award. It's not a real award, but mommy made it. And mommy made it when we only had two kids. Now we have three. So we have to put Betty in here too, right, Booker? Yeah.
Oh, well, it's very appropriate to have in the shot with Booker and, of course, with you. I've seen you and your kids on campus, and you are a wonderful dad.
How many brothers and sisters did you have? Zero. Any? You were only child?
Zero. I'm an only child. But my mom has 11 siblings, so I have a lot of cousins.
Wow.
And lots of people over the place. So big family, nonetheless.
Amazing.
Well, speaking of family, Jason, I would love to sort of hear about your early life. Of course, people know you now. They know Blumhouse. They know the movies, all those kinds of things, which we'll get to, certainly. But I would love to hear what it's like growing up in a house of artists, art professors. It seemed like a cool childhood. Tell me more about it.
Let's see. I was born in Los Angeles, but I don't remember that. And then I moved to New York when I was about 4 or 5 years old. I actually spent a year in Hamilton, upstate New York, because my mother taught at Colgate. And then I went to kindergarten and started school and my kind of young life in a little town called Dobbs Ferry, which is in Westchester, New York. And my parents were separated. So Monday to Friday, I went to school in Dobbs Ferry. And then Saturday and Sunday, I went into Manhattan and spent the weekends with my dad. And both my parents were really involved in the arts. My mom was a professor of art history at SUNY Purchase while we were living in Dobbs Ferry. So she would teach me all about the history of art. And my dad was a contemporary art dealer. Both my parents are still alive, but my dad, they're both retired now, obviously. And my dad had a gallery in New York called the Blumhelman Gallery. And on the weekends, we would go to museums and go visit artists and visit collectors. And so I had art coming at me from both sides, from my mom and from my dad.
Wonderful. And so despite that, you still chose to go into art. You didn't sort of repel it. You sort of said, I want to make this my life, right? Was there ever a moment where you sort of said, like, I've done too much of this growing up, I need something else that's not artistic? Or was it just a natural thing for you to take that on as a career?
Well, I think both the answer kind of is to yes to both things you said. I definitely was, clearly I was compelled by the exposure I had to the arts, but I was also didn't want to do the same art that, didn't want to be in, you know, studio art or visual art like my mom and my dad. So I chose a different category of the arts to be involved with. And that was my, if I had a little rebellion.
Rebellious spirit.
Yeah, exactly. It was that. And I really was interested in doing stories and arts for like a broad segment of the population, as opposed to, when I was young, you know, contemporary, people who like contemporary art, it's gotten more popular now, but people who like contemporary art were very, there were few and far between.
Exclusive thing, yes.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, I don't know if you know this actually, but I have another Blum connection besides knowing you, but your little brother and I went to school together.
I did not know that.
Yes, we were actually, and we were in the same college, no less. We were at classmates
at Yale
and in the same college. And
The
small little known fact is that my roommates throughout the years, actually, when I was a senior, I left to sort of be a freshman counselor, which is sort of like a Froco or a Stufel at Vassar. So I left the sort of rooming block. And so your little brother filled my spot in that rooming block with my long-term roommate. So we have a fake beef about it. But yes, I have known the Blum family in some way or another since my freshman year of school.
That's wild. So what was your roommate's name?
My roommates were Brian, Oli, and Max. And so senior year, he roomed with them. And I was sort of off somewhere else, but have love for them all and have seen him at a friend's wedding here and there. So
that's very
cool. Connection
to
some Blum people. Yeah.
That's very cool.
Absolutely.
Wow. I did not know that.
Yeah. So speaking of my college time, it's more about you really. So you came to Vassar and you studied film and economics. So love to hear sort of how you made that decision, quote unquote, and how you sort of understood those two things at that time. You can think back to your college years, how you thought about the intersection of those two things at that time in your life.
Yeah, sure. I really wasn't sure what I wanted to do when I got to Vassar. That makes me sound like I was much more prescient than I actually was. It just happened to be those are my two interests.
Of course.
I actually wanted to be an actor. When I was at Vassar, I was an actor, and I don't know if it still works like this, but technically a film major was a drama major with a focus on film. Most of the acting that I did was outside the drama department. And I guess without being aware of it, I was hedging. You know, I think even from, honey, if you talk, you have to go, okay? If you get bored, you can go and play with Joanna, okay? Or Cozy B. So I was hedging, I think, I don't think I was conscious of it, but I think that I was pursuing acting, but also there was a voice somewhere inside me saying, like, I'm not sure this is the right fit for me. I really was very lucky that when I was at college, I really loved it. I loved Vassar. The first movie we made with Noah Baumbach that was Kicking and Screaming, it was originally called Fifth Year. And really the idea of that movie was for seniors who had the wherewithal to realize life would be a lot more difficult the early years out of school than in school. Right. And it was about, you know, making up a way to stay at school for an extra year. So my college experience, you know, was terrific. I really loved it, even though I wasn't exactly sure what I wanted to do. And so I didn't complete an economics minor. I almost did. And then I went to Northwestern for the summer after I graduated to try and complete it. I got like two more classes. Then I needed one more class. I never actually completed it. But I was interested in the nexus of money and art.
Yeah.
And I'm still very, very compelled by that. I really look at the business today as like this kind of monopoly game of how do you make money making art, you know, directly correlated to each other. Right. And I think that's a really interesting, those two things, because they're kind of very diametrically opposed.
They seem to be, yeah.
Yeah, like money shouldn't really have anything to do with art. And most other art forms, it kind of doesn't, meaning you don't need a lot of capital to make a painting or make a book or put on a play even, but you need a lot of capital to make a TV show or a movie. So to me, that makes it very interesting. Like the good things about it, the bad things about it, the commercial pressures on the artistic creation. And I think from a very early age, I was very, very compelled by that. And that's why I had one foot in one and one foot in the other.
Yeah, of course. So of course I read your New York Times op-ed from a couple of months ago that spoke about this very thing in the contemporary moment. And before we talk about that, I'm curious to know sort of from your college years, from 91 on, it was a different sort of industry than it is when you wrote this op-ed a few months ago, right? And so sort of pre-2022 up until 91, sort of how did you see those things coming together? What was sort of the intersection of money and art like? And what were some of the insights at that time, I guess a pre-streaming world, I guess, right? What were some of the ways in which those things intersected in ways you liked, ways you didn't like, or any other insights you might have had about that?
Well, I always was very drawn to working on commission.
Okay.
And I had from an early age, like, you know, I've done all sorts of, you know, I worked as a landscaper. I worked as a gardener. I shoveled driveways. I painted. I did all sorts of jobs.
Wanted to earn your keep, right?
Like everyone. No, I don't mean it. I don't mean it.
I know it. No, I know.
I really don't mean it like that. But I was like, you know, my got summer jobs.
Yeah.
And I, from like the time I was 10, like I would much prefer like, I'll shovel your driveway for 10, it's going to cost you $10 up front, as opposed to I'll shovel your driveway for $4 an hour and see how long it takes.
Right.
I just always liked that.
Guaranteed.
And I had that with the first real jobs I had out of school. I sold cable TV as a door-to-door salesman and only got paid on commission. I was a real estate agent, which is, again, you only get paid on commission, which those jobs were extremely unusual for a 22-year-old. Most 22-year-olds who have to get a job to support themselves and not necessarily the field that they're interested in,
right,
wait tables, right? I didn't want to wait. I didn't want to be paid by the hour. I wanted to do these. I was very drawn by commission only. And so this is a long answer to your question, but one of the things that I loved about movies was this idea of like, you put this money together, you make the movie, and then you put the movie out in the world and you either make less, you make the same, or you make more. And if you make more, that's profit.
Right.
And it's boiling it down to its very essence. But that to me was really interesting. And my model has always been based, even when I've had the ability later on to get paid up front, I've more often than not, I forgo getting paid up front for a bigger piece of ownership in the thing I'm making, which if the thing does well, really pays off. If it doesn't do well, it's better to get paid up front. But I always like betting on myself since I was very, very young. And and that's one of the things, you know, that I liked about the movie business.
And the benefit of that, as I understand it, would not just be for you, but also for the artists who are also part of the production as well, right? It's not sort of a self-serving thing only where you end up doing better, right? But those who are involved in the production also do better at the end if they sort of have this piece of the pie, so to speak, to sort of make it do well at the end, right?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, I think that we can't ask other people to do something if we're not doing it ourselves. So of course, it starts with the writer, the director, the actor, all working for as little upfront as they're allowed to, in exchange for a bigger piece of ownership in the movie or sometimes in the TV show that we're making now. As you said, that's become more difficult recently, but it's still possible. And it creates a great spirit around whatever you're making. If you're all not really getting paid until the thing that you make comes out, it feels a lot better. You know, I always used to say this for a studio movie, like there's an actor and he's making $20 million for 2 months work. And then there's someone else making, you know, $20,000 for 2 months work. And it's something about that is not right. And I don't think, I don't think it's terribly conducive to productive creativity.
Yeah, I would also say, and this might be a little bit of a stretch, but I also think it probably wouldn't help sort of a general societal understanding or appreciation of the arts, right? It could make more resentment of those who are not in the industry, sort of saying, oh my goodness, these people just like, they're just making like hand over fist all the time, regardless. They don't have any sort of sense of like not a work ethic, but you know what I mean? It's a different sort of way people think about that industry if they just know they're going to get guaranteed money sort of all the time without any sort of skin in the game, so to speak.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
That's so cool. So on the heels of this New York Times op-ed you wrote, I'm curious to know what feedback you've gotten. And for those listening, sort of Jason has spoken about this very thing, the nexus of money in art. I don't want to sort of misquote you, but sort of noted that streaming has changed this dynamic in ways that weren't sort of relevant before streaming became so popular. So I'm just curious to know what sort of reactions you've gotten and what have been sort of the feedback and changes you've seen, if any, since you've sort of made this bold statement about the way that streaming might be able to go in the future.
Well, funnily enough, there have been a lot of changes. I don't think it had anything to do with my op-ed, but the landscape has shifted dramatically towards what I was hoping for. I think the streaming model for whatever I understand the reason, but I think it's dumb. The idea is that you get paid up front, and you get paid completely. You get your full compensation is up front.
Right.
Regardless if two people stream your show or 20 million people stream your show. And there are all sorts of problems with that. The biggest thing is it takes the fun out of it. It's way less fun. Also, you get people phoning in their work much more because they don't care they care to a certain degree. The director's name is still on it, whatever. But the streaming, the performance of something on a streaming platform is very opaque. You get paid everything up front. You don't really know how it performs or it doesn't perform.
Right.
So what I argued in my story is that when your interests are so misaligned between the financier, the platform, the streamer, and the artist, the producer, the person who's making the thing that's going to streaming, the quality of what what gets made is way down. And I don't think anyone would argue with the fact that the quality of what's on streaming, if you take the amount of shows and movies on streaming, what rises to the top is such a tiny, tiny bit. and I think the reason for that is because of their financial model. So it's very much swung the other way, because everyone was predicting that people wouldn't, when COVID was at least less of a factor in people's minds, that people would be much more likely to go to movie theaters. And that really hasn't happened. People are going to movie theaters, and movies in movie theaters are, the financial model is the opposite of streaming. They're transactional. So you pay to go see a specific movie. And then, you know, whoever's involved with that movie, you know, takes a piece of your $15, which is the exact opposite of the streaming model.
So I have a question about streaming, and I'm curious your thoughts on this. So you've just commented sort of on the quality that's produced as a function of the model, not necessarily the vehicle of streaming, but just sort of the model that streaming has used to finance and produce shows and movies. I'm curious how you sort of think about the volume of things on streaming with low quality versus what some might argue is sort of the benefit of having this broad sort of representation that streaming sort of allows that might not have been the case had we only relied on sort of a different medium of distribution, so to speak, right? So is there sort of this tension between the fact that streaming might allow for more stories, easily accessible, that people like to see and consume, even if in small numbers, versus like, yeah, but streaming produces really low quality stuff in the current model. Is that a real tension or not?
No, I think that's fair. Look, I think the fact that streaming has gotten more people to look at foreign movies and TV shows is good. Like, it's gotten people to read subtitles more. I think that's good. I think you want, your life is enriched by hearing stories who've had different experiences than the one that you've had. And people from foreign countries have had that by definition of living in another country. So yes, I think that's good. And initially, you know, and there's one other thing about streaming, which I'm going to talk about in a second, but initially I had really liked this idea of about 4 or 5 years ago, there was actually a cool, it was kind of like a communist idea, which is that basically you pay people the same across the board and a streamer would do very well on something that really hit because there would be no third party participants. And that would sort of cover the losses on the things that weren't that popular. But that has proven to be true less than I've thought, except for, except because if you talk to a streamer now, they we're looking for commercial material. You know, they're not, except for, you know, foreign language movies and shows, which I think is great that those are on streaming and the people are watching them, just like I just said. Now, the other thing about streaming, which makes me very against the streamers, of course, but I also think it's a reason that the quality on streaming is not good, is streamers don't value producers. They just don't. And the concrete evidence of that is that when they buy out a back end, they're willing to buy out a back end of an actor. That match their top number that the actor's ever made. They're willing to buy out a director, their top number the director's ever made. A producer's back end, they're willing to pay like 20% or 15% of what a producer's ever made. And that's because, like everyone who comes to Hollywood without a ton of experience in making movies and TV shows, they think the job of the producer they can do themselves. And they can't. And that's another reason why I think that that shows and movies on streaming are subpar, is because they really, really undervalue producers. As a result, they don't, they get less experienced producers. They don't get a lot of attention from very experienced producers. And that also makes the quality suffer.
And it seems like, to your point, the model also contributes to that in the current model, because they have to make up for sort of these top dollar front end payments somehow in the budget, right? I mean, they can't pay everyone their top rate at the front end and still come out in the black, right? So they have to sort of—
They seem fine doing that. I mean, that's what they do, do, except that they leave up the producer, but I don't, that's where they're choosing to save money.
That's where they're choosing to
Come back. Yeah, that's true.
Well, I have to ask, of course, about the genre of horror, because that's what most people know you for. It's what I know you for. And I remember I was in middle school. I don't want to date myself, but I was in middle school when Paranormal Activity came out. And that's sort of when I first got my introduction to probably modern horror.
Where was that? Where was that? Where were you?
I was in Fort Lauderdale. Fort Lauderdale. Cool. Yep. And that was my first sort of introduction to horror, and I loved it. Actually, before I go on, I'm curious, what were your sort of favorite horror movies as a child? Things that people might not even remember now, but right, but as a child, sort of these longtime classic horror films, what were your favorites, like your top two?
Friday the 13th scared me to death, but clearly I was drawn to it. And I really loved, I loved American Werewolf in Paris. I loved that movie.
Oh, wow.
Too. I would've... my dad took me to see that. I've always loved that movie.
I would have said Silence of the Lambs, and I probably saw it when I was far too young.
Silence of the Lambs,
and
that was good too.
It was really good. The other one I was gonna say is Children of the Corn scared the life out of me.
Oh, that was scary.
It was just
American Werewolf in London. Sorry, not Paris. I just realized.
In London.
I was just cool. In Paris. I
thought of that.
Those are scary movies for sure.
Yeah, I think the child aspect of Children of the Corn was just very real to me in some way. And so I couldn't get past that. But nonetheless, so you sort of started Blumhouse with this cool idea of sort of making these lower budget horror movies, which we talked about the finances of that already. But I'm curious to know sort of one, why horror? And two, sort of what do you think are sort of the fundamental building blocks of a horror film that would separate it from any other genre that one might name or think of?
The why horror is, I think horror is a great delivery system for independent subversive storytelling. And you know, if you independent movies are seen by very few people, but if they're horror movies, they're seen by lots of people. And if you look at the bulk of our movies, if you look at Sinister or Get Out or The Purge or all the, they're really like these really edgy indie movies, you know, tucked into with the genre kind of laced over them. And so you get to do really fun, interesting storytelling that a lot of people see. When I started, I was just making the independent movies without the horror part, and no one saw the movies. So it was frustrating. What was your second part of your question? I forget.
And then I was asking about, what are some of the fundamental components to make a horror movie?
Yeah, a good horror movie really, the components of a good horror movie are exactly the same as any other movie. People who don't really understand horror, executives who don't understand that or don't get horror, they're always like focused on the scares. The scares are really the easier part of a horror movie. The harder part of a horror movie is the story, the storytelling, and the acting, the performances. I always tell our executives, like a great litmus test for a horror script is if you read the script and you take out all the scary part, is there a great story that stands on its own?
And so when you say take out the scary part, you mean there's sort of like a fantastical, dramatic sort of thing that sort of would shock somebody or sort of get them out of their chair? Is that what you mean when you say that?
Yeah, what I mean is like, I often use the example in the beginning of Get Out, right? There's a deer hits the car.
Yeah.
It's like the stupidest scare you've ever thought of, right? I mean, how many times have you seen a deer hit a car, right? But it's incredibly effective. Like the deer, you remember it. The deer hits the car, it's like, holy shit. It's not because it was a good idea for the deer to hit a car. It's a dumb generic scare.
Right.
But it's brilliant what's going on before that.
Correct.
There's this white girl and this black guy, and she's saying shit that's like a little fucked up, but not really. And he's saying stuff, and he's going to visit her white. You know, it's so racially charged.
Right.
And you're so on the edge of your, whether you're white or you're black, you're on the edge of your seat. Like, this is uncomfortable. This car ride is uncomfortable. Yeah. What are they going to say next? And then a deer hits and you jump because you forgot you're watching a movie for a minute. You're just involved in the action. And Jordan, did that. So what's so brilliant about Jordan is not that he thought a deer hitting a car. What's so brilliant about Jordan is the writing and the directing and the way he got those performances and those two actors so that you forget you're in a movie. So when the deer hits, you jump.
Right.
And that's what, you know, that's why I say what makes a great horror movie is the same thing what makes a great comedy or drama, anything. It's the storytelling and all that stuff. If the lead up before the joke is good, you're laughing at the joke. If the lead up before the scare is good enough that you forgot you're watching a movie, you can have a really kind of generic scare and it works great
because
you forgot you're watching a movie for a minute.
That's amazing to hear. I have to say, when you talked about the dear moment from Get Out, it reminded me of my experience watching Get Out, which I'm sure you've heard many folks reflect on over the course of your life. But if I could take a moment to share mine, I remember I watched it. I think I might've been in Connecticut watching it at a movie theater. And it was so interesting because, of course, it was sort of a mixed race sort of theater. And I say that because you just sort of brought up sort of the racialized component of the movie, which is not subtle, obviously. And it was so awkward because, you know, there was a moment where people couldn't quite, I could not understand if people thought it was comedy or they thought it was horror or they thought it was a combination of both. And it was sort of one of these first moments, you know, of course that happened before 2020 and George Floyd, but it was sort of like, huh, people understand race really differently, right? And
yeah,
this is a horror movie. And I know it's sort of not about race sort of broadly. It is about race clearly, but it's not sort of a, we're not having a lecture about it, but it was sort of a moment just based on the reactions of like, huh, this is a diagnostic for how people might understand race or at least choose to metabolize it in their own sort of world, right? And so I left feeling like, I don't know what this means. I have that reflection now, but at the moment I was like, oh, this is like an odd thing to experience live in the theater with other people, right?
My favorite thing, which, you know, maybe we had a different experience, maybe we didn't. Well, we definitely had a different, I would presume we probably had a different experience at the beginning of the movie.
Right.
But my favorite thing about Get Out is that you enter the movie, and I think Black and white people watching the movie are experiencing the movie very differently.
Right.
Clearly very differently, right?
Right.
But then, as the movie progresses, we're all on, everyone gets on Daniel's side.
Yes, it narrows.
And so it really like literally brings kind of disparate points of view very together on one.
Right.
And no one, unless you're a sociopath at the end of that movie, it's is true. Not like, I'm fully seeing this from this guy's point of view. And this family is a fucking family of psychopaths.
It's true.
That's actually my single favorite thing about Get Out and about watching Get Out with an audience is watching like the, and I've seen it with a lot like you, I've seen it with a lot of audiences though, and watching the beginning of everyone kind of a little uncomfortable and then everyone comes together. It's fun.
Yeah. Well, it's funny. This also, of course, makes me think about the difference of sort of the movie or show watching experience when you're doing it in a community versus when you're doing it sort of as a streamer, right? Because you're likely doing it by yourself as a streamer, right? And so you don't get sort of the ambient sort of insights or reactions that you as the producer, director, whatever, might want me to get from it if I'm sitting there watching it by myself, right? It's a different sort of thing.
And the experience of I mean, just to put a finer point on it, like it's actually, I never thought about it in this context, you always, but like you just can't have the experience of sitting and watching this movie and sitting next to someone who's a different race than you and they're right here.
Right.
It just makes the experience of the movie completely different.
Exactly.
Because you're not, when you're watching at home, you're not like, I wonder what they're thinking, right?
Or watching them react in a certain way in the time, right? So it's a very different thing. And I wonder if in the future, if people who make movies will think about how they make them differently, knowing that people might not watch it in community, but rather watch it as an individual person. It's not, it's sort of like podcasts, right? People know, people listen to it often by themselves, as opposed to like the radio or sort of a TV show, right? Where people are sort of watching it with their families or whatever else, right? So it's interesting sort of media, you know, projection, so to speak. We'll see how it goes.
It really is.
So I guess one other thing I'm curious about relative to horror, and you sort of spoke a little bit about this in a recent Guardian article, is sort of that, you know, we're living in a really crazy time, of course, as everyone knows, and sort of what is horrific has moved from being so fantastical to being like closer to real life and what we're actually experiencing day to day. And so how do you and your peers think about creating horror that really, one, has the same effect on people because it is still like scary and it's imaginative, and living with the fact that like the world is really messed up and it's hard to sort of create so many other worlds that are more messed up than the world we're currently in now?
Yeah.
You know, if we got that kind of intellectual about it, you would lose your audience. You know, this isn't exactly the answer to your question, but it kind of is that when we're talking to artists and writers, directors about storytelling and horror movies, you know, I always say like the same thing I'd say if it was any kind of movie, but draw on personal experience. Is there something that you really care about? You know, think of a story that talks about it, but you can't, I don't think you can reverse. I got in trouble about saying this a week ago or something, because I said, you know, I'd never make a movie about global warming. And of course we are making a movie about global warming. But what I meant when I said that is, I think it's, you're really tail wagging the dog if you say, this is my issue, and then I'm going to make a movie about it. I mean, I think you need to kind of tell a story that you feel personal about, and then usually it, you know, there'll be bigger themes drawn out of it, and then you can work on it. Like The Purge, James, The Purge was initially a story, you know, James got cut off by someone on the freeway in Staten Island. He's like, I'm going to kill that person. And his wife
I've said, had that reaction.
Yeah. And his wife said, like, you should make a movie. Like, what if you could 12 hours illegal killing was illegal? And that turned into like a big movie about gun control.
Right.
But he didn't start with a movie about gun control, I guess, as a way to
that. That makes sense. And I guess one other piece of this is, how have you and your teams grapple with thinking about horror as something that's sort of culturally informed, or I guess the stories that would be the stem for the horror, like those of course could be like Get Out culturally informed, understood differently by different people, and has the industry sort of incorporated that, or is there still ways to go in terms of creating stories that like are legitimately scary and dark and deep, but are sort of maybe not broadly understood to be that way just because like the mainstream culture, mainstream viewers don't understand it that way. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think as a company, we're drawn, the people who work at the company who work there a long time, we have a similar kind of mind meld. You know, we're attracted to, you know, some material that has things to say. It's not exclusively what we do. We've made some horror movies that literally have nothing to say except they're scary and fun. But most of what we are attracted to, generally, you know, horror movies that have something to say. So that's a reason that we continue to do them. And then we do them, then we keep the price down, so that by keeping the price down, when a studio is scared to make it, I can always say, listen, this is so little money. How can you, care? Right. You know, if we went to Universal and said, we're going to make a $20 million movie about gun control, they'd throw me out of their office. But if we went to Universal and said, we're going to make a $2 million movie about what if crime were legal 12 hours a year, they gave it a wide release.
Right. Cool. Well, I have a couple other questions, and then we have a quick rapid fire round of sort of our student hot seat questions. Vassar students, you are one of them. They're very thoughtful. They're creative. They want to know all your business. And so I have a few questions that I'll ask from them second. Just one last thing before I get to that is sort of what's next for you? Sort of where do you see your work going? Where do you see Blumhouse moving to, if anywhere different than horror and the way you've been doing it? And how does sort of the mode of delivery, like streaming and the way that happens, how does that influence where the next 5 or 10 years of your work might go?
Well, what's next for us is we're definitely doubling down on theatrical movies, which was kind of up in the air for a while. And I definitely think that I'm very focused on delivering 4 or 5 wide theatrical releases a year. One or two of those would be from, you know, existing IP sequels. We have 3 Exorcist movies coming out over the next 3 years. And then one or two will be original IP. That's the biggest thing that that's the biggest single thing that I focus on. I make sure every day that I'm working towards that goal. Cool. In addition to that, you know, we're growing our television business. We've had a lot of success with our TV company in terms of our shows, and we've been nominated for a lot of things and like that. I haven't turned it into the successful business that the movie company is yet. Yep. It's successful, but it's not nearly as successful as a movie company. So I'd like to figure out how I can have shows that people see that are successful, but also that really turns into a really, really profitable business. So those are the 2 things I'm looking at the moment.
Cool, wonderful. So just a few questions, then we'll be on our way. So the first, and you don't have to be specific, no proper nouns in this answer. The first question is, what has been your most difficult experience working with a creator on a project?
You know, that's actually a great question. And I've had a fair share, but still the one that comes to mind is I really wanted my model, you know, it's probably gonna give away what it is, but whatever, I don't care. I really wanted my model to work for a Western, and we really got very, very close. with this one Western that we made. We had a great cast and everything, and I felt like, looking back at it, it felt like kind of a hit and run to me. And I feel like if we had collaborated more, it's like a great regret of mine, is because I think it would have opened up a different business for the company.
Yeah.
I think it would have been really cool to make Blumhouse Westerns. And I think we could have made a lot of them had this one experience gone better. And it was very frustratingly contentious. And that's the kind of the most frustrating experience I had.
Can I tell you, you would have had an immediate fan in my mother. I grew up watching so many Westerns. I know all of Gunsmoke, all of Bonanza, Little House on the Prairie. I am like not a Westerns fan, but by osmosis, I just happened to be so familiar and loved them because they were always on the TV growing up. So you would have had a fan in my
life. We had the opportunity to bring it back, and we had a tough situation with that creator. But that's my biggest regret.
Here's the hoping. The second one is, here's interesting. Yeah. What are your top two sort of criteria in project selection when you're thinking about taking on a new project? Sort of what do you think about as the top two things that need to be sort of checked off in order to take on a new project?
We have to have a real, real belief in the director.
Okay.
That's the first thing. And the second thing is, on the movie side, and TV side is different, but on the movie side, because we've been talking mostly about movies, I have to have a real belief in the director, and I have to have some notion of how the movie will be sold. Those are the two most important things I look at.
Cool. Two more questions. The first is, who have you not worked with who you would like to work with in the future? Either the director, actor.
I'd like to work with Quentin Tarantino.
Okay. Cool. Wonderful. I think many would. Yeah.
I sent him a script recently, and he almost liked it. So I was close.
And the last question is, you can take it however you want to. What does horror look like in the Blum household for the children? And what was your, similar to that, sort of as you were a child, what were you most afraid of growing up?
Well, bullied is such a heavy word.
It means a lot, yeah.
It means a lot. But I had a terrible experience at the boarding school I went to. My freshman and sophomore year, it was really, really bad. So it was a full-blown NC-17 horror movie for me. That was the horror movie of my life. Now, what are you asking about my
children? And then for your kids, right? They've grown up with someone who makes
the horror movie for my kid. The horror movie for my kids is like, you know, is democracy falling apart, which is our friend Donald Trump.
Yeah.
So I think that's the horror movie for my kids is that somehow, you know, they don't grow up in the democracy that I did.
Yeah, that's a real horror, I think, for all of us, frankly, not just for kids, but any sort of rational thinking adult.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Jason, for joining us at Conversations of the Salt Line. Frankly, one salt line that I think permeated our whole conversation is this balance between commercialization and art. And it seems like you've found a way to balance it. So I look forward to seeing you do that in the future and enjoying what you've done so far.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me. And I'm seeing you later, right?
I'm seeing you for dinner in just a couple hours.
All right, great. I'll see you soon.
Perfect. Thank you.
Bye-bye.